بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com, your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed Explained from the book Aqidatu Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farisi.
The next chapter regarding the meaning of the word Lord, Ar-Rabb in Quran and the Sunnah. Originally, Rabba Yarubbu means to raise up something, to build up something from a stage to another stage. So Rabbahu means build him up. Rabbahu, educated him or built him up. They say Rabbabahu also. Rabbabahu, Rabbahu, Rabbahu, all the same. And to add A and L to this word Rabb, this is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rabb. So no one is called Ar-Rabb except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because A and L, if they are added to the word, give the meaning of ikhtisas, speciality, and give the meaning of also general superiority. So when we say Ar-Rabb means he is the only one who deserves all the perfect meanings of lordship. All the perfect meanings of lordship. رب العالمين ربكم ورب آبائكم الأولين. So it should not be mentioned for other than Allah, except by attaching the word to something, by saying, for example, رب الفرس, he is the lord of this horse, or the master of this horse, meaning he is the owner, he owns it, and so on. But you cannot say he is the Rabb. No, you say he is رب الفرس, he is رب الدار. He is the owner of this house, the master of this house. So in Arabic, the word Ar-Rabb is only mentioned for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or it is mentioned in a way which يعني, makes it clear that it is Allah. Like saying, Rabbul Alameen. No one is Rabbul Alameen but Allah. Rabbul Nas, the Lord of the people. No one deserves this but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the meaning of Rabbul Alameen, as the author says, is the creator, their owner, the one who does what's in their favor, the one who builds them up from a stage to another stage, the one who sends his favors to them by sending his messengers, sending his books, giving them rewards for their actions. So as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says, the Sheikh quotes Ibn al-Qayyim saying, Rububiyyah shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders his worshippers and forbids them from certain things, and he gives them reward for those who do good and he punishes those who do evil. This is the meaning of Rububiyyah. So even those nations before us, they believed in the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Quran saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken an oath on Adam and his descendants. This was way back before creating Adam. or before blowing the soul into him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rubbed over Adam and he gathered all descendants of Adam in his hand. And he told them, am I not your Lord? They said, yes. So this is a testification. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, everyone is born on that implanted instinct in them. That is, Allah is their Lord. So their parents lead them to Christianity or Judaism or etc. So if anyone is let alone to grow up, he would not be denying lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It would take some external source to affect him to go and disbelieve in Allah's lordship. Otherwise, if you take a human being and put him somewhere without an external effect, he will be raised up believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is something which has been implanted in him. So he will, as long as there is no external effect, it will be there. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in a true hadith, quoting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he says, I created my worshippers straight on Tawheed, but the devils took them away from Tawheed and led them to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that is Allah, your Lord, your true Lord. So what is behind the truth except astray? And as Yusuf alayhi salam said to the imprisoned people with him, what is better, several lords, different lords, or Allah, the only one, the only mighty? What you are worshipping besides him, they are only names that you have named. Yani you call them Allah or whatever you call them. Allah has not ordered you to do this. Now, to associate partners with Allah in lordship, this could occur by considering someone else as a creator. Just like we mentioned about some of the mushriks nowadays who believe that their saints or the awliya have some kind of power, effect in provision and things like that. This is believing in lordship. Also, we had some mushriks before were attributing some of the effects which occur to the stars and to the paths of the stars, the paths that the star circle. They used to attribute certain incidents to them. And some of them claim that those idols do hidden things. Then the Sheikh says, the contemporary grave worshippers, as well as the previous grave worshippers, claim that those dead people intercede for them with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that Allah gives them what they want. And they say, we worship them only to make us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or bring us closer to Allah. And they worship them when they can do no harm and no good, and they say they are our intercessors to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Sheikh brings some statements to reply on those people. First, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has replied on the idol worshippers by mentioning to them that those idols do not benefit you and do not harm you. Therefore, they are not lords. Therefore, you cannot worship them. And if those idols cannot benefit themselves and cannot prevent the harm from themselves, how can they prevent the harm from you, and how can they benefit you? Yani this idol, if you beat it hard, it will break. It cannot help itself. So you want it to help you? If it could help, it could help itself. And then the verses regarding what Ibrahim alayhi salam done with his people, and he proved to them that those idols don't benefit and don't harm. And the only answer they had is, we found our ancestors doing this, so we follow their steps. This is not an answer. This is not an answer. This is an answer of someone who has given up, who has given up, from someone who is in a weak position. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also replied on those who worshipped the sun and other creation, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shown that they are under his control. He is the one who runs them as he wishes. So how could they be worshipped besides him? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has replied on those who worship the angels and who worship Jesus and the pious people by saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not beget, and he is not begotten, and he doesn't have a wife. How could he have a son when he doesn't have a wife, and so on. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن نبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله. This is chapter 5. And in this chapter he started with the title that Tawheed al-Rububiyyah must result in Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, or the one who admits of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah is obligated to admit Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. This is a relation between Tawheed al-Rububiyyah and Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, that is the relation of istilzam. That means the Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, if someone admits that there is no Lord except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he should be obligated to admit that there is no one worthy of being worshipped but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this has been explained in Quran, as the author inshallah will point out to it clearly from the verses in Quran. Now the opposite is to say the relation between Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah and Tawheed al-Rububiyyah is not that of istilzam, but it is that of tadammun, containment, or inclusion. Maybe a better translation than containment. That means that if someone already testifies that there is no one worthy of being worshipped except Allah, then that means he necessarily testifies also that there is no one who is Lord, Creator, Master, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, why would he single him out in worship? He did not single out someone in worship if he did not believe that he is the Lord and he is the Creator and the Master. These are the two relations. One is between Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah, and that is istilzam. And one between Uluhiyyah and Rububiyyah, the opposite, and that is tadammun. The author is talking now about the first one, Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah, and that is istilzam. That means someone who admits that Allah is the Creator, Allah is the Lord, Allah is the Provider, the Sustainer, and so on, he should be obligated to testify to La ilaha illallah, that there is no one worthy of being worshipped but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. the author says the meaning of this is that anyone who admits to tawhid al-rububiyyah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this means that he admits that there is no creator or provider or runner of the affairs and controller except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, it is an obligation on him. يَلْزَمُهُ لُزُوم obligation. It is an obligation on him. He should be obligated to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone by all forms of worship. And this is Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, to worship Allah alone by all forms of worship. Because Uluhiyyah is worship. As Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma explained the word Allah, he said, ذو الألوهية والعبودية على خلقه أجمعين. He explained the word Allah to mean ألوهية or عبودية. So, إله or معبود. إله and معبود is the same thing, which means the one who deserves all the worship. So no one should be supplicated to but Allah. No one should be called in hardships and difficulties but Allah. No one should be depended upon by heart except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one should be sacrificed for except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so on. Any, all forms of worship should be for Allah alone. Therefore, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah is a proof for Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. It is a proof, meaning the fact that you admit to Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, then you should admit to Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. This is a proof for Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. It's a proof enough by itself. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps mentioning this when he speaks about those who deny Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Like the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, verses 21 and 22, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ عُبُدُوا رَبَّكُمْ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ الذي جعل لكم الأرض فراشا والسماء بناء وأنزل من السماء ماء فأخرج به من الثمرات رزقا لكم فلا تجعلوا لله أندادا وأنتم تعلمون. O people, O mankind, single out your Lord in worship. Single out your Lord in worship. Make all worships for the one whom you believe to be your Lord. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling those mushriks, you admit to my lordship, therefore you should admit to my worship. اعبدوا ربكم. Worship your Lord. Meaning, you admit that I am the Lord, I am the creator of heavens and earth, I am the sustainer, I am the provider, then admit to my worship alone. That is, to worship me alone and not to set up rivals with me in worship. Just like you have not set up rivals with me in lordship, you should not set up rivals with me in worship. As simple as that, as clear as that. And at the end of the second verse, verse 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not set up rivals to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. When you know that there is no Lord but Him, there is no creator but Him, there is no master but Him, there is no provider, no sustainer but Him. So you know that Allah is the Lord. Therefore, this is a proof that you should single him out in worship. This is a proof that you should stop associating partners with him in worship. This is a proof that you should not set up rivals with him in worship. And this verse, like many other verses in Quran, is a clear cut proof that Tawheed is divided into Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, worship your Lord. And he's saying this to the Arabs who admitted to the lordship of Allah, but they did not admit to the worship. So this is not a repetition. Worship your Lord does not mean believe the lordship of your Lord or admit to the lordship of your Lord. This has no meaning. They already admit to the lordship, which shows that اعبدوا ربكم, worship your Lord. We have here two different things. We have worship and we have lordship. And the Arabs used to admit to the lordship, but they did not admit to the worship of Allah alone. They used to say, Allah is the greatest deity and he is the greatest one who deserves to be worshipped. But at the same time, they believed that angels and pious people whom they used to make statues and pictures in their form, that those are little gods, that those are ones which are worshipped so that they become intercessors to the greatest one who is in heavens, and that is Allah. This was the way of the Arab pagans. Sheikh says, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered them with Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, that is to worship him alone. And he has made a proof against them, the fact that they admit to the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who has created the creation, all of it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that they admit all that. They admit that Allah is the creator and the provider and so on. That's why he said, وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Don't set up rivals with Allah when you know that there is no Lord but him. Therefore, the natural way to prove Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah is to use Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, the Tawheed of Lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The human will attach his heart first to the source of his creation and to the source of his good and evil, good harm and benefit. Then afterwards, he goes to the means which bring him close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make him pleased with him. So Tawheed al-Rububiyyah is a gate. It's only a gate to Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. It's a means to Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah is the goal. Tawheed al-Rububiyyah is the means. That's why all prophets started their call with Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, because it is the goal. While the ignorance nowadays who mix up the concepts of Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah, and some of them totally misunderstand the distinction, they start with Rububiyyah actually, and some of them start with rulership, which is not even all the Rububiyyah. It's only a division of Rububiyyah. So therefore, those people who misunderstand the Tawheed and the distinction between Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah, they really are calling to something which is only part of Tawheed. Of course, rulership has two aspects. When we speak about the rule itself, the action of ruling, of making legislation, making halal and haram, this is rububiyyah, because this is the right of Allah alone. But when we speak about our action, that is to seek rulership, then this is uluhiyyah again, because this is our worship, that is to seek rulership with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the book of Allah and the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there is a difference between hukum, which is the action of ruling, that is for Allah. He is the only one who makes the rulings. And tahakum is our action. We seek rulership. So tahakum follows uluhiyyah. Just like ta'ah, obedience, follows uluhiyyah. It is our action. And we mentioned earlier, more than once, that this is a clear distinction between rububiyyah and uluhiyyah. Rububiyyah is to unify Allah with his actions. And ruling is one of his actions. Therefore, no one would be a muwahhid, a follower of tawheed, if he does not single out Allah for rulership. But also, rulership has another aspect, and that is tahakum, which is our action. We seek rulership with the book of Allah and the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's an obligation on us, just like any other obligation. Salat, siyam, zakat, hajj. So all these are worships and actions. Therefore, tawheed al-uluhiyyah, which means to unify Allah with our actions, while tawheed rububiyyah, to unify Allah with his actions. So this is in regards to the distinction again between tawheed rububiyyah and uluhiyyah. Going back to what the Sheikh says that tawheed rububiyyah is a gate for tawheed uluhiyyah. It's a means. Tawheed uluhiyyah is the goal, and tawheed rububiyyah is a means to tawheed uluhiyyah. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used this logic in Quran, and he ordered his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ, say, to whom belongs the earth and all that which is in it, if you were truly to know. They would say, to Allah. They would say, to Allah, it belongs to Allah alone. So they admit that all the ownership is for Allah. And this is an admission of Allah's lordship. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قُلْ, say, أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ, won't you remember, meaning won't you remember that he is also the only one whom you should worship, or who you should worship. So this is the way of Quran, to remind them that they admit the lordship for Allah. And therefore, if they were to remember, if they were to think properly, then they should unify Allah in his worship. قُلْ مَنْ رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ السَّبْعِ وَرَبُّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ, say, who is the Lord of the seven heavens and the mighty throne? They would say, to Allah. Say, أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ, won't you avoid shirk in worship? Won't you be aware of shirk in worship? Won't you fear Allah and leave shirk in worship? Since you admit to the lordship of Allah, you should fear Allah and admit to his worship also, and not worship others besides him, and not set up rivals with him in worship, in supplication, in calling, and so on. Then the same thing. قُلْ مَنْ بِيَدِهِ مَلَكُوتُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ يُجِيرُ وَلَا يُجَارُ عَلَيْهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ سَيَقُولُونَ لِلَّهِ قُلْ فَأَنَّا تُسْحَرُ. Say, who is the one who owns everything? And he is the one who gives support, and no one gives him any support. If you were to know, they would say Allah. Allah is the only one who fits that description. Again, by this they are admitting the lordship of Allah. Say, how could you be affected by magic? Yani, as if someone has made magic to them and they cannot see the truth because of magic. Meaning that you admit to the lordship of Allah, then there is no reason why you should not admit to his worship, except that if you were sick by magic or something, someone have made magic to you. Otherwise, why don't you worship him alone? Why don't you worship him alone? Why don't you single him out in worship, just like you have singled him out in lordship? And in another verse also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ رَبُّكُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ خَالِقُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ فَاعْبُدُوهُ. That is Allah, your Lord. No one is worthy of being worshipped except Him. He is the creator of everything. Therefore, you must single Him out and worship. فَاعْبُدُوهُ does not mean here worship him. It means single him out in worship. Because the Arabs, although they did not single out Allah in worship, but they worshipped Allah. They were more worshippers for Allah than the current saint worshippers who claim to be Muslims. Because the Arab pagans, although they used to set up rivals with Allah in times of easiness and relaxation, but in hardships, they would supplicate to Allah purely, and they would forget about what they have made up of gods. They would forget about them in hardships. But the current mushriks nowadays, they would not remember Allah in the worst hardship, in the most difficult hardship. You would not hear any one of them say, "Oh Allah." You would hear them shouting, "Oh, this person and that person," calling upon pious people or even unpious people whom they think to be pious. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it clearly, "I have not created the jinn and the humans but to worship me." Again, "but to worship me" means "but to single me out in worship." Abdullah ibn Abbas said, "Kullu amrin fi kitabillah, i'budu rabbakum, ay wahiduh." Every order in the book of Allah which says worship your Lord means single him out in worship. Otherwise, the Arabs used to worship Allah. They used to fast. They used to pray. They used to make hajj. They used to make umrah. They used to make tawaf. They used to make talbiyah and tawaf. And they had many, many other worships. They used to sacrifice animals for Allah. They used to give oaths for Allah. And many other worships. But because they used to commit shirk also, sacrifice for other than Allah sometimes, give an oath to other than Allah sometimes, supplicate to other than Allah sometimes. Therefore, the Prophet ﷺ was ordered by Allah to tell them, "Wala antum abidun," you are not worshipping. Because for someone to worship Allah and then commit shirk, he cancelled his worship. Therefore, he is not worshipping. The Shaykh says, وَمَعْنَى يَعْبُدُونَ, the meaning of يَعْبُدُونَ, يُفْرِدُونِي بِالْعِبَادَةِ, to single me out in worship. To single me out in worship. This is the meaning of worship me. It means single me out in worship. Don't set up rivals with me in worship. Otherwise, you would not be worshipping me. This is the meaning of the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Worship me. And one would not be following Tawheed just by admitting to the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until he admits to the worship of Allah and acts by it. Otherwise, the mushriks were admitting to the lordship, and that did not make them enter Islam. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept fighting them despite their admittance that there is no Lord but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And despite the fact that they were truthful in saying that there is no Lord but Allah, they were not lying. Otherwise, Allah would say that you are lying or that those people are lying. Just like what Allah said about the hypocrites when they said to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, نَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. We testify that you are the messenger of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allah knows that the hypocrites are lying. So when they are lying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposed them. But here, when the Arabs were asked, who is the creator? Who is the Lord? And they said Allah. Allah did not say they are lying, because Allah knew that those people truly admitted that there is no Lord but Allah. But they did not admit that there is no Ilah, one who deserves to be worshipped, but Allah. And they said, as Allah mentioned about them in Quran, when they objected to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they said, أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا. Is he going to make all the gods one god? So they admitted that there is one Lord and that there are different gods. One Lord and different gods. More than one god. They admitted to that. And what they were doing with other gods, they called it worship. And they admitted that they are worshipping them. They said, أَجِئْتَنَا لِنَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ وَنَذَرَ مَا كَانَ يَعْبُدُ أَبَاؤُنَا. Oh Muhammad, have you come to call us to worship Allah alone and leave out behind us what our ancestors were worshipping? So they know the meaning. They were Arabs, and the Quran was revealed in their tongue. And they knew what is the meaning of worship and what is the meaning of Ilah, God. They knew it. Therefore, their actions, they knew that they were worships. So they admitted. They said, yeah, we are worshipping. But we are only worshipping them to make them steps between us and Allah, to make them intercessors to Allah, so that they carry our needs to the greatest God, Allah, who is in heavens. They admitted to all that. The mushriks nowadays, especially those who claim to be Muslims, they don't understand the meaning of the word worship. They don't understand the meaning of the word ilah. They don't understand the meaning of shirk. They don't understand any of this. They do 10 forms of worship, and when you tell them that you are worshipping other than Allah, they say, no, we are not worshipping. This is not worship. Okay. They supplicate to humans like them, and maybe dead humans in the graves, and they don't consider it to be a worship. They sacrifice animals for them, and they don't consider it to be a worship. They seek blessings from them directly, and they don't call that a worship. They make them intercessors between them and Allah without the permission of Allah, and they don't consider that to be worship. Then what is worship? They say worship is only to believe in them that they create. This is not worship. This is lordship. This is lordship. This is not worship. Worship is your action. Your sacrifice of the animal to please this engraved so that he becomes an intercessor between you and Allah. Your action of slaughtering an animal for this purpose, this is worship. Your supplication to the engraved, this is worship. And the fact that you believe that this engraved creates, this is not worship. This is beyond worship. This is different. This is lordship. And we have nowadays people who claim to be Muslims, who not only make worships for the engraved, but they believe that those engraved have been given the ability of providing, creating, sustaining, running the affairs of creatures. So this is far beyond the shirk of the previous people, because the previous people did not believe in this, because this is shirk in lordship, not in worship. Then another verse the Shaykh brings, which is similar. Ask them or say to them, who is the one who provides for you from heavens and earth? Who is the one who owns the sight and the seeing and so on? Who is the one who brings the live from the dead and the dead from the live? Who is the one who runs the affairs, controls the matters? They would say to all that, فَسَيَقُولُونَ اللَّهِ. They would say, Allah. So nothing which falls in the category of lordship except that they admit that it is for Allah alone. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say that they are lying, because Allah knows that they admit to this. But this was not enough for them to become Muslims. So how could it be enough for people now to become Muslims? Just to admit that Allah is the creator and the provider and so on. This is not enough. This is not Islam. The only gate to Islam is La ilaha illallah. No one is worthy of being worshipped except Allah. And La ilaha illallah is not just an empty word or a word without meaning. No. The author says, you find this a lot in Quran. So anyone who claims that Tawheed is to admit that Allah exists, or that Allah is the creator, the runner of the affairs, and feels sufficient with this category alone, then he actually does not know Tawheed that the messengers were calling to, because he stopped with that part which is a means but not a goal. How could you be satisfying the condition that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put on you when you stop at the means only and do not reach the goal, which is the testification by tongue, by heart, by action to La ilaha illallah, that there is no one worthy of being worshipped except Allah. So lordship is malzum, and uluhiyyah, worship, is lazim. And you stopped at the malzum and forgot about the lazim, which is the part which is necessary from your saying that Allah is the only Lord. This is the lazim, the part which is necessary, the part that you are obligated to do. Lazim comes from luzum, which is obligation, while malzum is the thing which you base the obligation on. Or, to say it easier, you stopped at the dalil, the proof, and you left the madlul upon, which is the thing which you have proved. The thing that you have proved is that no one is worthy of being worshipped except Allah. You did not satisfy this. You satisfied the proof to this. Why did you stop at the proof? It's like proving something and then not doing that thing. What's the benefit? So the fact that you admit to the Lordship of Allah, this is the proof that you should go beyond and worship Him alone. So if you don't worship Him alone, then don't tire yourself and don't prove anything and don't even say that there is no Lord but Allah. There is no advantage to say that there is no Lord but Allah and then stop right there and not do the result of this, which is no one is worthy of being worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And amongst the special points regarding uluhiyyah, the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most perfect from all aspects. No deficiency whatsoever can be attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, this is a great proof that no one should be worshipped but Him. If He is the only one who fits this description, the utmost perfection, then how could you worship someone who does not fit this? You cannot worship anyone who does not fit this description, that He is the most perfect in His knowledge, in His might, and so on, in all His attributes. And as a result of this, you should worship Him alone, you should glorify Him alone, you should fear Him alone, you should supplicate to Him alone, you should desire in Him alone, trust in Him alone, and call upon Him and supplicate to Him in hardships alone. And you should put your utmost submission with your utmost love for Him alone. This is an obligation. The true thinking necessitates this obligation, as well as the proofs in Sharia necessitate this obligation, as well as the natural instinct which Allah has implanted in you necessitate this obligation. So it is unacceptable by thinking and by the Sharia and by the natural instinct that worship could be for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a continuation in Kitab al-Tawheed for the Honorable Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan. And in this session, he is speaking about Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, the unity in worship, to worship Allah alone. And he includes 8 chapters in this session. The first is regarding the meaning of uluhiyyah and the fact that this is the call of all messengers. Second chapter is about the two shahadas, the meaning of those two shahadas, the pillars of the shahada, the conditions of the shahada, and the requirements of the shahada, and finally, what breaks this shahada and nullifies it. The third chapter is regarding legislation, tashri', and that is to say something is halal or haram, and to say that tashri' is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of this chapter, which is very important, and the Sheikh made it as one of the items in Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, and indeed it should be given this weight. Unfortunately, some contemporary so-called Salafis almost disregard this subject when they speak about Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. And we have some contemporary ignorance also who speak about nothing but legislation and tashri' when they speak about Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, which shows their ignorance of the meaning of Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. And this ignorance actually has been initiated by Sayyid Qutb and Muhammad Qutb. Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah to them is tashri' and this has been said clearly by Sayyid Qutb in many of his writings, and it has been quoted also by some of his students like Dr. Safar al-Hawali in his book Zahirat al-Irja', where he quoted Sayyid Qutb saying this without actually commenting on it, even though Safar al-Hawali himself, Sheikh Safar, understands what goes in Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah because of his background and because he was strong Salafi, at least great student of knowledge, if not a scholar. And then the Sheikh goes into the fifth chapter and showing some misconceptions regarding defining the worship and some examples of shortcomings or exaggerations in this subject. And then the sixth chapter showing the pillars of ibadah like fear and reverence and love and so on. Seventh chapter explaining the two conditions of accepting good deed, and that is sincerity in intention and the following of the sharia or the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And finally the eighth chapter in showing the different ranks of the religion, Islam, Iman, Ihsan, giving definitions of those ranks and relations between them. Regarding the first chapter of this session, the Sheikh says, Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, Uluhiyyah is worship. The Sheikh says, Al-Uluhiyyah hiya al-Ibadah. And this has been said by Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma when he explained the name Allah in Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in the beginning of Surah Al-Fatiha and Ibn Kathir and other tafsir books. They quote Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma explaining the name Allah, that it means ذُلْ أُلُوهِيَّةِ وَالْعُبُودِيَّةِ عَلَى خَلْقِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ. The one with uluhiyyah and ubudiyyah or ibadah, worship. The one who deserves uluhiyyah or ibadah. This is the meaning of Allah. The only one whom we should specify and worship. So this was explained by Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma. And before Abdullah ibn Abbas, there are two hadiths or two narrations of a true hadith which explain this. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu to give da'wah to the Jews in Yemen, he told him, let the first thing that you should call them to be shahadatu an la ilaha illallah, that they should testify to la ilaha illallah. In another narration, the Prophet ﷺ said, let the first thing that you should call them to be إِلَىٰ أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ, that they worship Allah alone. So the companions used to narrate about the Prophet ﷺ by meaning, and that's okay, that's acceptable, as long as nothing changes. So the one companion said that the Prophet ﷺ said that he told Mu'adh, the first thing to call them to is La ilaha illallah. Another companion said that the Prophet ﷺ told Mu'adh, let the first thing be that you call them to Ibadatullah wahdah. So this means that Ibadatullah wahdah is the meaning of La ilaha illallah. And the companions of the Prophet ﷺ used to narrate about the Prophet ﷺ by meaning sometimes, as long as the meaning is precise. There is no problem in that. And still another narration of this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, وَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلْ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ شَهَادَةَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. In another narration he said, وَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلْ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ أَنْ يُوَحِّدُوا اللَّهِ, that they unify Allah. So tawheed is la ilaha illallah. And all this means ila an ya'budu Allah wahda, that is to worship Allah alone. These statements were made by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or at least, if not made by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these are statements of the companions who narrated about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they only narrate the precise meaning. They don't narrate wrong meanings at all. So the Sheikh says, Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah is to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all actions of the worshippers that they do in a way that they want to please Allah with. Like dua, calling or supplication, like nadr, like sacrifice of animals, like reverence and fear, like dependence and trust, like repentance, like submission, like sincerity, like tranquility or devotion. All these are actions of the heart regarding the actions of tawheed in the heart. And also like salat, siyam, ruku', sujood, and other actions of the worship of the limbs. And this kind of tawheed, the Sheikh says, is the subject of the call of all messengers from the start to the end. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this in Quran, Surah An-Nahl, verse 36. We have sent to every nation a messenger, starting with this order, اعبدوا الله واجتنبوا الطاغوت, worship Allah and avoid false deities. Worship Allah means unify Allah in worship. As Abdullah ibn Abbas also said, every order in the book of Allah which says اعبدوا ربكم means وحدوا. Every order in the book of Allah which says اعبدوا ربكم, worship your Lord, means وحدوه, single him out and worship. This means that if someone worships Allah but he commits shirk, then he did not worship Allah. If he worships Allah, let's say in fasting or prayers, and he commits shirk in dua or supplication or fear or something like that, then he has not worshipped Allah. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell the kafirs, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ. This is a complete declaration of disallegiance with the kafirs because they commit shirk. And the Prophet ﷺ was ordered to tell them that وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ, you are not indeed worshipping Allah. Even though the Prophet ﷺ was seeing them by his own eyes making hajj, which is a worship, making umrah, which is a worship, going around the Kaaba and saying لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ لَبَّيْكَ, but then adding some other garbage to it which makes it nullified and shirk. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seeing them doing all those worships, he still was ordered to tell them, you are not worshipping Allah because your worship will be a waste if you mix it with one form of shirk, a single form of shirk. So how about if you mix your worship with various forms of shirk, like supplicating to the wali, like sacrificing to the wali, like seeking the blessings from the place where he is engraved, and many other forms of shirk, then you will be like Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab and the rest of the gang that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considered to be kafirs and ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to declare that he has nothing to do with them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said also, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُونَ, that we haven't sent a messenger before you except that we revealed to him that there is no one worthy of being worshipped except me, so worship me. This is Surah Al-Anbiya, verse 25. And every messenger starts his call when he is sent to his nation by ordering them to worship Allah alone, as Nuh said, as Hud said, as Salih said, as Shu'aib said. They all were quoted in Quran to say, Ya qawmi ibudu Allah ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. O my people, worship Allah alone, for you have no God besides him. This is in Surah Al-A'raf, verses 59, 65, 73, 85. And Ibrahim alayhi salam told his people the same thing. This is in Ankabut, verse 16. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, I have been ordered to fight the people until they testify to la ilaha illallah and that Muhammadan is the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Bukhari and Muslim. And the first obligation on every person who has reached the age of puberty, the age where he starts to be responsible for his actions, the first obligation is shahadatu an la ilaha illallah. This is the first obligation. Unlike what the innovators claim, that the first obligation is to look around you so that you become guided to the existence of God and so on. The first thing that everyone is ordered in order for him to become a Muslim is to utter the two words, Shahadat la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammad al-Rasulullah. Of course, knowing its meaning, not just uttering it without knowing what it means. Therefore, the Sheikh says, this makes it obvious that the goal of the message of all messengers is Tawheed al-Uluhiyah. And Uluhiyah is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like in the name Allah. And then he explained it in the way that we narrated about Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma. It is also called Tawheed al-Ibadah. Tawheed al-Uluhiyah is also called Tawheed al-Ibadah because al-Uluhiyah means al-Ibadah, the worship. So Tawheed al-Ibadah is to unify Allah in worship. And here, one should notice that when we say Tawheed al-Ibadah, Ibadah is the action of the created of us. So therefore, Tawheed al-Uluhiyah is to unify Allah with our actions, with our love, with our fear, with our prayer, with our supplication, with our sacrifice. While Tawheed al-Rububiyyah is to unify Allah with his actions, which are special of him, like creation, providing, and so on, lordship and legislation, and so on. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah mentions, as the Shaykh quotes, one must know that the need of the slave for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to single him out in worship and not to associate any partner with him, any partner in any way. Allah has no example so that one can give examples of. He has no example. He is the creator and no one else is the creator. Everything else is created. Everything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is created. So how could one make an analogy between the creator and the created? Shaykh al-Islam says that the slave's relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is different from his relation to things which are necessary for him, like food and drink, because the reality of the slave's needs are what's in his heart and soul, and he has no way of salvation except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the owner of our hearts and souls, provides our hearts and souls with that which is beneficial. Otherwise, our hearts and souls will not feel secure, neither in this life nor in the hereafter. And if it would happen that some kind of pleasure occur to someone without being related to unifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship, then this pleasure is not only temporary but short. But as long as someone has a good relation with his Lord, then because Allah is with him, then he will feel the pleasure. This is mentioned in volume 1 of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah's Fatawa, page 24. So this kind of tawheed, the Shaykh says, is the subject of the call of the messengers because it is the foundation that all actions are based upon. And if it is not satisfied, then no actions will be accepted. Because if it is not satisfied, the opposite will occur. The opposite will replace it. The heart cannot be empty. If it is not full, if it is not occupied with Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, then it will be occupied with the opposite. If your heart is empty of the love of Allah, then something else necessarily will substitute it. And if your heart is empty of the fear of Allah, then again something else will substitute it, and that is the fear of the creatures, and so on. And without achieving Tawheed, all actions will be worthless. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah has determined that He will not forgive shirk, and He will forgive what is less than that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if they were to commit shirk, then all their actions will be cancelled. This is in Surah Al-An'am, verse 88. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you were to commit shirk, then all your actions will be cancelled and you will be amongst the losers in the hereafter, that is. This is Az-Zumar 65. And also, this kind of tawheed is the first obligations that the worshipper must do. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, worship Allah alone and do not associate any partners with Him, and do good to the parents. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, your Lord has ordered that you worship none but Him and to do good to the parents. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, say, let me recite on you what Allah has made haram on you. First, not to associate partners with Him, and to be good to the parents. This is Surah Al-An'am, verse 151.